Live from the 1480 AM studios, KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the show. I'm Dave Long. Hey, Joseph J. with a cowboy hat. And that's that. Trisha.
And shut up and dance with me, Dave.
Okay. I don't know what that means. Is that the title of the song? Oh. And we have Eric and the lovely Kathleen behind the glass. Oh, where'd Eric go? Oh, there he is. Hey, I see Kathleen,
what,
but
did I become invisible all of a sudden?
No, Joseph.
He only
was,
has eyes for her.
No. Joseph was blocking
you.
Well,
you're
out.
His wife. I think it should be you.
Yeah. What the heck? What is going on here? You're getting me in trouble. Eric is
Dave.
Like,
I don't think you have any problem getting yourself in trouble.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, Eric is like 6'1". He could take me out in probably the first round easily. But no,
I'm
Joseph,
a lover, not a fighter.
Oh yeah. He can he could love Kathleen first, second, through 12 rounds, no doubt. Am I right, Eric?
I'm thinking 18 holes of golf.
That's like a half a day. Oh, my gosh. What vitamins are you on? I want those vitamins. No, Joseph's hat was blocking you.
I think the pills I take are one of our sponsors.
Oh, really? Is that the Pepsi by, who's that, Robert Dole? Remember he used to do?
Bob Dole.
Oh, Bob Dole.
Bob Dole.
That was weird, yeah. Right?
It was just a little blue pill. That's
did
all.
You see the Democrat convention?
I've seen all the highlights.
Yeah, so you didn't actually see the whole thing.
I couldn't sit through all that.
It's a lot, you know, and it's quite a stage production. You know?
I liked when the Democrats were yelling, lock her up.
No, that was the Republicans.
No, the Democrats were too.
They were too?
Seriously?
Wow, I didn't hear that part. Oh, my. It's quite a battle out there, you know? And now FBI, I guess, is investigating some hacking of Hillary's...
Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
Well, that and Hillary's campaign stuff got...
Something got hacked. They just told
something
us
got
on
hacked,
the news
man.
Last night, yeah.
I don't know.
That's because Donald Trump asked them to hack it.
Yeah, he... yeah, that was sort of weird.
I don't know, but that was, that looked very strange. He was flirting what? With somebody on Periscope or something, and he's like, oh... Turning
they're
on,
they're complimenting
he's,
me.
He's like, I do like the John.
We're talking about politics. I don't know politics, so I
like
have to
the
pay
hat.
Attention to
it's,
people.
It's
John. What'd you say?
It's jauntily askewed. I like that. Yes, yes.
Jauntily askewed.
Actually, believe it or not, you look really good in hat.
Thank you.
In that hat. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This is the hat that I wear for my
musical.
You should wear
a hat that covers your whole body.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
Where's my defenders? I used to have defenders on here.
Who? I don't remember.
You remember when you guys used
well,
to say
I think
mean
when they
things?
Changed, they would... When they changed the age,
I never said
when
it.
They changed the age to minimum of 18. I think
oh,
they
okay.
have.
Oh, you mean oh. who won the poll?
LOL. He looks amazing in this hat.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Chica Vega says.
I think you
shout
look,
out Chica
you,
Vega.
Yeah, no, really. I think you look good. It brings out your eyes and
thank
your
you.
Smile.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Is
so.
Chica Vega a girl or a guy?
She's a girl. She's a 19-year-old girl.
He's a girl?
Chica.
She is a girl, a 19-year-old girl. Shut up. She's
is
very
that
nice.
Too old?
Shut up and dance with me. Come on now.
You can't say shut up to Eric.
She's very nice. I defend people.
You can say whatever you want.
You can? Oh. All right.
Shut up
so.
And dance with me, Eric. Of course, that what?
Okay, I won the poll.
No, that of course was "Walk the Moon" with "Shut Up and Dance with Me" from the soundtrack of Bad Moms.
Not bad. Is that what you
well,
said?
We'll find out. We'll find out in just a few moments, actually. Oh. But yeah, Bad Moms. We're kind of celebrating that in our first segment today. New movie, a comedy. So we got a couple songs from that.
Oh,
but that's the song that they sing in the car near the end, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Can't remember.
This woman is my destiny.
Joseph, I got a movie
ooh,
for you.
What?
Ooh, which one?
The Donald Trump Art of the Deal with Johnny Depp.
Okay.
On Funny or Die, you got to watch that. That is hilarious.
Okay.
Oh, is it? I hadn't heard about that.
Johnny Depp is Donald Trump, and he does it to the T.
Oh,
wow.
Is that right? Oh, I have to check that out.
That's amazing.
Yeah, FunnyorDie.com. Just go there and watch that. It's about an hour long.
Oh, it is?
Oh.
Wow.
Okay.
Ooh.
Well, Dave, the show is an hour long, so it means don't turn it on right now.
No, I want to do it.
No, because we got to do the show because we got some great guests. In addition to
we
reviewing,
got to do the show. We
well,
get to do the show.
What?
It's our pleasure to do
yes,
the show.
It is.
It's our pleasure and
yes.
honor.
And in addition to reviewing Bad Moms, we also have on the winner of America's Got Talent season 6.
Oh,
woo! Landau. Whoa. We've got some fans out there. Landau Eugene Murphy Jr., who will be joining us because he's going to be in town. You get to see him at the MIM Music Theater this Wednesday, August 3rd.
The Musical Instrument Museum.
Exactly. Yeah, he's going to be there.
Oh, very cool.
What does he do?
He sings. Well, we got some music from him.
Yeah, excellent.
And I know that you've got a guest coming up as well, Dave.
I do. Sean Burke, traveling the country, wrote a book called Reset America. I believe.
Pressing America's Reset Button.
Oh, you remembered. I think it's in my car. I better get it. But anyway, he went evidently to both conventions. I don't know if he got in, but he was outside when it was in Cleveland and at least in Philadelphia. So we'll see what happens.
Okay.
Get his take on that. Right. It's not really political, but just he's trying to get people to vote who you want to change or who you want best for America, actually. That's
and
all.
Actually, the official title is How to Press America's Reset Button.
Excellent. Very good.
Joseph, you look like, I'm looking at your screen there, you look like Woody from Toy Story.
Ah, hey.
You know, you do,
you know what?
Actually.
I was him once. Not him, actually, like in real life, but I was...
Like
I played
for Halloween?
Well, not for Halloween, for Christmas. So I did that the
Christmas?
Yes, for Christmas. I did the Electric Light Parade. That they have the in Phoenix, right? The APS Fiesta of Light Parade. I was in that. I made a float with my international baccalaureate program in high school.
Root beer float?
No, not that kind of float. Root beer barrels. Okay.
What the heck is going on?
That was when we had Pee-wee Herman.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Our keyword was... Root beer barrels.
We were watching that movie. That's funny.
Oh, yeah, you were? The Pee-wee movie? Yeah.
Yes.
It's a good movie. It's a good movie. But I played Woody because our float, we had like all the toys and stuff, and I was Woody. And, yeah, and, but the only thing is the announcer called us the International Bachelorettes.
Bachelorette.
Funny now.
Instead of baccalaureates.
Baccalaureates.
Baccalaureates or whatever.
Yeah. And so.
Here are the international bachelorettes. And I'm going like.
Yeah, that fits perfectly.
Oh, yeah. Fantastic.
All and, lit up.
We're always wondering.
Here's Woody, the bachelorette.
Yeah. Yeah. The kids that year were a little upset. But anyway. That was before the Bachelorette and everything was on. By the way, I wanted to recap last Saturday's bar crawl. No, yeah. In case you were wondering, Bobby did not show up.
Oh, Bobby.
She did not show up. I was
Bobby,
what?
You would have been lucky.
I wasn't wondering because I knew she wouldn't.
It was
she
very
did
disappointing.
Once. She did once to the last
that
graffiti
was, what,
bar
ago?
Crawl.
Long time ago.
But the good news is I was periscoping. Well, no, let me clarify that. I was drunk periscoping.
Oh, that could be dangerous.
Yeah, that was, yeah.
Hey, you know, it's what? Like letting your friends text on your phone.
Oh, yeah, it
and
wasn't
they
good.
Send a booty text.
It wasn't
know?
Good. I people said after the fact, they said, you might want to watch your broadcast. So, yeah.
What was it?
Was it pornographic?
No, it wasn't pornographic.
You were actually drunk?
Yeah, of course. Why not?
What do you mean, of
you
course, why
you're
not?
Drunk?
You're the person who used to, like, maybe drink one drink and
that's
you
all it
on
takes.
Your butt.
That's all it takes. It was one drink. It was one drink at Fat Tuesday. It was a slush. I had the grape shot.
What's more amazing is that there's still Fat Tuesdays around.
Yeah. Well, and that was, I was I drank that, and then...
Well, there's actually a drink.
See,
where was it? And it's called, like,
Ash
Grape
Sot,
Kool-Aid
right?
or something.
Right.
I think it's, like, Grape Kool-Aid, and it's at... I think it's at Tilted Kilt.
And Loose Lips Sink Ships. I found that out.
Let's try and say that three times.
Your ship got sank?
My ship sank. Yeah.
Congratulations.
And Ash says, yeah, it was so funny.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Oh, they saw that?
By the way, that was on my private account. That wasn't on the Breakthrough Entertainment
oh,
account.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
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 We
otherwise,
but that was
you'd
fun.
Be in trouble.
We don't want a bad reputation.
No. It was fun, though. It was fun. It was, and then I said sobering up, and I did a scope like that. And then, like 10 minutes later... They offered us free shots, so I created a periscope saying, free shots! And then my battery died.
Shot.
Yes.
So,
but it was
shot,
fun.
So you had a good time.
Of course. I always have
what
a good time.
Was your
shout
most
out to my friend Danielle.
Danielle. And, oh.
Yeah.
Danielle.
Was she your designated driver? She took care of you?
No, she wasn't. I was okay by the end
was
of the
was she your designated kisser?
No, but she was the one that was in the parking lot. I told her about by the way.
Oh,
what is that face?
Oh, that we were looking. We were. Oh, because we were spying on you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I told her. I finally
she
told her about that.
She still sees you?
Yeah, she's my friend.
Oh.
Did you know? Actually, my favorite picture of Elvis as a little boy was wearing a hat just like that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So I'm a little boy now, right?
Well, it means
you could have been
like 10 or 12.
I look at the hat and I see the Elvis picture.
Oh.
Okay. It's a very famous Elvis picture.
So Joseph, so did you
what? No, I went home alone. What is that the question?
Sort of.
Oh, okay.
Home alone.
I'm sorry.
Look young. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so you liked it. So what was your what, you winking?
What, they said you winking? Look young.
He's, oh my God, he's winking at
you. You know
the
what?
Periscope.
I know. He's definitely
I
got
caught
ADD.
That. And it's like,
well, no, before that, you should have seen when I first called it out. He was like,
just keep your hands on the table, will you?
I have to have
okay,
one.
So. All right, so Joseph.
What, my favorite part of the night?
I thought that was funny. But anyway, no, your favorite drawing of some. Whatever you put on.
What I put on someone?
Yeah. How does that?
My favorite was the crazy hot scale from How I Met Your Mother. I drew
I don't know what that is.
It was basically a scale. On the one side it's hot and the other side was crazy. And then you say how, you know, where you are, where that girl is on that.
You didn't draw
schedule.
Like a Mount Everest or.
No, I wrote some things that probably should not be said on the air.
Okay, you don't want to
say. Yeah, we don't want to say those on the air.
All right. Those would be, are those you a good artist or did it matter?
Oh, it didn't matter. I drew a blue French horn. That's just.
How do you spell blue?
let's just
how did you spell rest. Blue?
I just heard it in my head.
Now, how do you spell it?
B-L-E-U, because it's French.
Okay. Well, you know.
Yeah, blue cheese.
There's different ways. Different words have. Okay.
What time are we at?
I don't know, but this is a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is. It is.
I want to talk about bad moms.
Yeah, let's talk about bad moms.
Okay,
because you know what?
We are talking about bad things, so that's appropriate.
I really want to mention how they did such a great job marketing this.
Yeah.
To all the moms groups.
Oh yeah.
Everybody that was there was a group of moms. It was so funny. Young
like
moms,
it.
Fun moms,
yeah.
Bad moms, but that are really good moms.
Good moms.
It was really fun to talk to some of the people that were coming out as we were going in, people that were, you know, in
other
theaters
of moms
and
too,
stuff.
But yeah.
The ILFs.
Oh my God.
Okay. Bad moms. Mila Kunis.
I think those are called MILFs.
Oh,
Mila Kunis.
I can't control it in here, guys.
Mila Kunis plays an overworked.
Until I hear one of those seven deadly words.
Then we're okay.
Okay.
All right, we're going to step it up.
Well, no,
by the way.
We'll work towards that.
Actually,
no. I retract that. Don't step
up. Okay.
Actually, remember in Seth MacFarlane's movies, Mila Kunis is a bad word, right?
I guess.
Yeah. I don't remember.
I think she's beautiful.
She's
love
awesome,
her eyes.
Actually.
And I see where she got them from. I see where she got them from.
Oh, my God. Retract that immediately.
That's a joke from the movie.
Oh.
It's a joke from the movie.
Exactly. Remember?
She looks far too foreign.
Is that dumpable?
No, it's a... No, it's
from... She's awesome.
No. It's from the movie because
it was... A foreign woman says she looks too foreign.
Yes,
it's like, okay,
exactly.
You look even more. So.
It's called ironicism. That sounded...
I hear beeping.
Yeah,
okay.
It was weird.
What was that?
That was probably...
I know what it is now.
All right, well, Mila Kunis plays an overworked, overcommitted, and exhausted mother who joins forces with two other overstressed moms, played by Catherine Hahn and Kristen Bell, on a quest to liberate themselves from conventional responsibilities, going on a wild, un-mom-like binge of long-overdue freedom, fun, and self-indulgent, putting them on a collision course with the PTA president, played by Christina Applegate, and her clique of devoted perfect moms, played by Jada Pinkett Smith and Annie Mumolo. Yes, Bad Moms tries to be as bad as it possibly could. And it succeeds at being a very, very bad movie.
Ooh.
This movie is unfunny.
What? I did laugh.
I laughed maybe once at the scene when Kristen Bell was in her hoodie that she's never going to wear again. Yeah, that was funny because the expression
on
her face.
You would like that scene, I know.
The expression on her face was cool because no, she probably shouldn't wear that hoodie anymore. But I thought it was very unrealistic, completely unrealistic, and just
shocking, right?
I don't even think it was shocking. It was just. I hate using the word stupid, so I'm not going to use that word.
Oh, okay, but you sort of did.
Yeah, just anything. I don't know. I was just sitting there. I was like, why is this movie even made? I don't know. I'm somewhere in between a 1-star and 2-star. I think I'm going to end up giving it 2 stars just because the talent involved. I think that Catherine Hahn is an excellent actress, yes. Kristen Bell is just sort of like eh in the movie, except for that one scene, in my opinion.
Oh, I think she's way underrated as an actress.
She has been in the movie. I didn't think that she was that great in here.
She's been Sarah Marshall. I mean, I think she's talented.
Yeah, I do too. I do. Yeah. Mila Kunis, I thought was okay, but
I liked her role.
Okay.
No?
I thought that she was kind of bland.
Would you go out with her, though?
I don't know. I don't know her real personality that well.
Wow, what are you getting? Inner beauty depth stuff?
Of course. Of course. But she looks too foreign.
Mila Kunis looks too foreign.
No.
It's a joke.
He's making a joke because they were actually talking about a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white girl, and the person stating it was someone who was less stereotypically stereotypically foreign looking.
Build the wall.
Exactly. It was a joke. Exactly. Yes. So that's why he's trying to. But if you haven't seen the movie, you wouldn't know.
Right. But you could see the movie.
No, I'm definitely not going to see the movie.
Well, yeah. I would recommend you not see the movie. Like I said, probably 2 stars for me. I laughed maybe once and then chuckled a couple of times, but most of the time I was just sitting there. I mean, it has a really good soundtrack.
I loved the soundtrack.
Yeah, it was a good soundtrack. Yeah. But that's not that's very faint praise. So, Dave, what did you think?
Well, I somewhat agree with you that at most I give it 3 stars. And the value, the reason I go from a 2 to 3, because I don't think it was a very good movie, very predictable. But I do think it was sort of realistic by exaggeration. I think it was trying to reflect the role that working moms or single moms have and how much they seem to do versus a lot of their spouses.
Yeah.
So I think they exaggerated that part. So that's probably the unrealistic part to you.
Who pumped the gas today?
But what? So anyway, but I think the acting was fantastic. Kunis, excellent. Hahn, excellent. Bell, excellent. Applegate played a sort of uncharacteristic role, I think.
I like the scenes when they were actually partying, I don't think that was very appropriate for anyone to be smashing things and drinking in the store and then, you know, whatever they did, but it was kind of amusing, like a music video to watch.
Well, yeah, and again, they exaggerated that, you know, getting rid of the frustration, the stress, and from that point, I thought it was good. I think if you ask moms, they're going to like it because the ones that go through that feel that stress. Now, they wouldn't necessarily do what was in the movie, but it was something that I believe is relatable more to moms than maybe you and I.
Okay. All right. So 2 stars from me, 3 stars probably from you. Trisha, real quick, so we can get to our guest.
Okay. I would give it 3 stars because it did make me laugh, but I had to suspend everything because it was just so polarized with stereotypes of the both extremes instead of just middle-of-the-road fun moms that the rest of us are.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Very good. Very fair. And so now another song from the movie. You'll recall this from, isn't this from the grocery store scene? Yeah. Let It Burn.
Oh, that was a good song.
Yeah, it was a good song. It's a really good soundtrack.
I call
it fun,
this the I
scene.
Don't Care song. I don't care.
Oh, we got Eric involved, too. Come on, Dave.
I don't care.
Oh, yeah.
I love it.
Oh, yeah.
I love it.
I don't care.
Hey, how do I sound, Eric? Can I be in a group?
Well, no, actually, I think
group of non-good singers.
I think we're going to leave the singing up to our
Eric.
Landau.
Yes.
Yeah, we'll leave our the singing to the next guest.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But this is fun. I crashed my car into the bridge.
Okay.
I don't care.
Oh, yeah, you don't care, but guess what? This is Breakthrough Entertainment Live on 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. We'll be right back.
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like a fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black.
I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in the boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning.
And welcome back again. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment live on 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. That is not me singing. I wish I had that voice, but I am Dave, alongside Joseph J., Trisha, Eric, and lovely Kathleen. We now, Mr. Joseph, have a fantastic guest, a voice like, wow, one of the top voices I've heard.
Yes.
Do the honors, Joseph.
Well, of course, we have, and he's singing right now, by the way. Joining us on the phone, we are honored to have on Landau Eugene Murphy Jr., of course, from America's Got Talent. He is the winner of season 6. And so he's, of course, singing the song right now. And joining us, Landau, how are you? Good morning.
How's it doing?
Great, great. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I understand you are going to be coming here to Phoenix in just a few days. August 3rd, you're going to be at the Musical Instrument Museum Music Theater on Thursday, August 3rd, right?
Yes, I will be there. I had a lot of people from your area, especially my auntie, asking me, like, when are you coming to Arizona? Like, when are you coming to Phoenix area? No, you know, so we're blessed to be able to add you guys to the tour. And I'm ready to come out there and have a fantastic time.
Well, you have such a great voice, I got to tell you. You sort of, you know, in a way, sound like Frank Sinatra a bit.
Yeah, I've heard that a lot.
Which is good. I mean, that was even before my time a bit, but I love hearing Frank Sinatra. Do you do other styles too, or is it mainly in that era?
He does one of my favorite, Nat King Cole.
Right now, it's mainly in that area, but I do all genres. The only thing I haven't done is bluegrass, and I'm working on it.
Oh, wow. Good for you.
Well, you're from West Virginia, right?
That's right. I gotta do bluegrass one day or another. I have to.
And by the way, we have people asking on Periscope who we're speaking with. This is Landau Eugene Murphy Jr. He is the Sinatra singing season 6 winner of NBC's television's America's Got Talent. So tell us first of all about your experience on America's Got Talent, because I mean we've had on a couple people from this season. So you know, what has that done for you?
It allowed me to, you know, share my blessing, you know, with the world. And that's the most wonderful thing about America's Got Talent, is that they give you that platform, especially for people that, you know, that are basically scared of the industry and all these different type of things that, you know, go through your head when you step out into that light. But it's just, you know, it was a blessing for me to be able to stand up in front of, you know, 15 plus million viewers and sing that song, stick that gum in my pocket and set my life in motion. You know, it basically put my life in a place where I'm living my dreams every day. I wake up in, you know, a lot of wonderful hotels. I own a home. I own a vehicle. I mean, I'm not on the streets anymore. So, I mean, America's Got Talent was basically my savior at that moment in my life.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Now, of course, Trisha's got a question, but I do want to mention for our Periscope viewers, interactive feature. If anyone has any questions for him, please type them out, and we will ask Landau. But before Trisha asks her question, who were the judges on your season, by the way, and who was your favorite?
It was Piers Morgan, Sharon Osbourne, and Howie Mandel.
Okay.
Oh,
and
wow.
I was really leaning toward, you know, Howie Mandel, but all of them, you know, treated me so great. I can't really choose between the three. I mean, I think everybody has to play their roles on these reality TV shows, you know. But, behind the scenes, they were just genuine human beings, you know. And I got a chance to go on the Piers Morgan show and do a show with Laura Johnson, you know, one of the background singers on my Vegas shows. And he treated me, you know, as if he known me all my life. It was never nothing weird about any of them. Sharon Osbourne is a breath of fresh air, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Howie Mandel is super cool, you know. He almost shook my hand, and I went in for a fist bump and missed my opportunity. So it was just, it was cool, man. They treated me great. I mean, I think they did that because I was just basically just being me. It was nothing fake about me on that show. It was nothing, you know, when the cameras came around, I never changed my attitude. I never changed, you know, my persona. So I stayed the same, and they genuinely love that because, you know, in Hollywood and places like that, you don't really get to see a lot of, you know, normal down-to-earth people. Everybody's got some type of agenda or in the clouds in some kind of way, you know. So to see a person coming from humble beginnings and trying to stay that way, they really embraced it, I think. And it allowed me to just be myself and, you know, rub off on them a little bit of that good down-to-earth mentality.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. Trisha.
So you kind of alluded to your background, but for those who haven't had a chance to read your biography, give us the Reader's Digest condensed version, please.
You know, just a small town boy from Logan, West Virginia. Parents divorced. Mom moved me from West Virginia to Detroit. You know, I learned how to adapt to the gangs and all the streetwise people. And then I ended up being homeless for a second, and then started washing cars just to, you know, pay my bills and keep food in my belly and things like that. And then I went on that show, America's Got Talent, and it changed my life forever. You know, it's just now I'm living my dream.
Well, and the reason I brought that up was because it would be very easy. One of the things you were talking about is being a down-to-earth person and wanting to stay true to your roots and true to being, you know, the humble person. And you just released a special CD. Tell us a little bit about Come Home to West Virginia.
Come Home to West Virginia is just basically highlighting the most beautiful thing about, you know, my life and that's where I was born. You know, I love West Virginia. I know around the world we get a bad rap as far as, you know, the hillbilly and all of that redneck stuff and inbred and all these other things from Hollywood and TV, but, you know, it's one of the greatest places on the planet. I mean, most of all of Hollywood and TV that we grew up watching came from West Virginia. I mean, the NBA logo is Jerry West. He's from West Virginia. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Jimmy Jakes is from West Virginia. Steve Harvey is from West Virginia. Mm. Jennifer Gardner. You got so many people that's from West Virginia. Gilligan. You know, from Gilligan's Island.
He's Bob Denver?
Yeah.
Really?
Bob Denver is from West Virginia.
Where'd you think, you know, he was from Denver?
Rocky Mountain High from, in Colorado.
From that's John Denver.
Oh, John Denver.
That's John Denver.
This is Gall.
Wow.
Oh, no, that's Gomer Pyle.
That's
sorry,
Gomer
I'm
Pyle.
Getting
yeah,
mixed
we're getting
up.
Bob Denver? Is that what you're saying? That's
yeah,
Gilligan.
Bob Denver. Bob Denver was Gilligan. That's what.
Bob
yeah.
Denver.
Now, Don Knotts is from West Virginia.
Oh, see, Don Knotts.
From
oh,
the
wow.
Andy Griffin Show.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't know that.
Yeah, you got Bill Withers.
Mr. Farley.
Just the two of us.
Yeah.
We can make it if we try. Ooh. Just the two. That's West Virginia. You know, Steve Harvey is from West Virginia.
Well, you know what I love?
I remember
I
him
so
from the beauty contest.
The wrong envelope.
I just love so much that you know, your look that I see in various pictures of you. Your look, you just come across as just suave.
He's got
and
swagger.
Debonair,
he's
and
got
you
swagger.
Got swag. You got, you know, it's like, wow. You know, and what I love also about this that you didn't say, and I think it's because you are so humble, and that is that some of the proceeds are going to go to benefit the Children's Home Society of West Virginia.
Oh.
Is that
oh,
like
definitely.
Close to your heart, or how did you come about to have that partnership?
See, that partnership came way before the fame, TV, and all of that stuff. I mean, I was doing that when I was basically still homeless. I was going around singing for homeless and abused kids.
Oh.
You know, and things like that at different charity events around West Virginia. And so once I, you know, became famous and got big, I thought, you know, why walk away from that now? You know, when I can be a major platform for a voice for all of those kids and all the homeless people around the world or people that are being abused in general. So wow. That's something dear to my heart. I was doing that, you know, 8 to 10 years prior to America's Got Talent.
Yeah, excellent. And if anyone's... Go ahead. I'm sorry.
and I'm not going to walk away from that. So what I did is my second CD to doing the Columbia Sony album, I did a Christmas album that all the fans started asking me to do. They was, Blanda, we can't wait to hear your Christmas album. So we went in the studio and knocked out this Christmas album. We gave the proceeds to the Children's Home Society of West Virginia.
Wow.
Oh, and now this Come Home to West Virginia song that I just did, and I released it on West Virginia Day. And we didn't expect to, you know, have this big tragic flood and all this stuff going on. So we decided to take the proceeds of July and probably even the next month to come to give all those proceeds to the flood victims. And, you know, and it's raised over $500,000 around the world with us all coming together. Mm-hmm. Jennifer Garner, Brad Paisley, what's his name? Glenn Leonard, all of us, you know, some of the Temptations, the Platters and Drifters, Billy Ray Cyrus, we all got together and we did this telethon in Bluefield, West Virginia. And we raised, you know, over $500,000 for the flood victims in West Virginia. So it's been going great. And my fellow musicians and the entertainers in New York are coming together right now and also putting, you know, their efforts together to help out everybody. So it's just something that we all supposed to do, especially when you get a blessing. You get a blessing, you got to remember to pay it forward, or it's never going to be a blessing.
Very true. I love your attitude.
Great attitude.
If anyone's just now joining us, we are speaking with Landau Eugene Murphy Jr. He is the season 6 winner of America's Got Talent. He's going to be performing at the Musical Instrument Museum Music Theater this Wednesday, August 3rd. And so I know Dave's got a question in a second, but someone from Periscope, by the way, said that it comes natural to you when we were talking about the swagger and everything like that. So they said that comes natural to you. And they also ask, before Dave asks his question, what are your musical inspirations? What are your inspirations?
I would say gospel music was a big inspiration in my life. You know, it creates all the emotions and all the loves. It keeps you all attached to, you know, humanity. And then you can go into the R&B and, you know, the Motown and the soul music and things like that. And once I get into that genre, it's Marvin Gaye, it's Stevie Wonder, you know, it's Michael Jackson, and the Commodores, and Earth, Wind, and Fire, the Gap Band, you know, it's just by Curtis Mayfield, you know. And I grew up on all of that, and Prince, and, you know, but then I also have the genres like Cyndi Lauper, Bryan Adams, John Cougar Mellencamp, you know, Duran Duran, Toto, just about anybody, Boy George, Wham. I grew up on all of these things. That's why I love, you know, the fact that God moves in mysterious ways. I didn't know that I was going to be born in West Virginia, you know, and then grow up on all of that stuff and then be taken out of that into Detroit, Michigan, where it's just Motown, you know. So I was exposed from just basically here in Sugar Hill Gang in West Virginia.
I love it.
right. You know, you understand what I'm saying
hotel,
now? Like going
hotel,
from Sugar Hill Gang
Holiday Inn.
straight into, like, you know, the hardcore Run DMC and the Crush Groove movement, and then Heavy D and the boys, Salt and Pepper, what is their name? Public Enemy, you know, then you go on the Far Side, Tupac, Biggie, Snoop Dogg, and all this stuff. So I got every bit of that all balled up inside of me.
But
know?
See, that's
the
awesome.
Best of both worlds. Yeah, but G-Eazy. I also had a Bing Crosby.
G-Eazy.
Bing Crosby.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he loves Bing Crosby.
Oh,
yeah.
Crosby, Dean
I
Martin.
I love Bing Crosby every morning when you heard that, especially around Christmas time. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas.
Ooh, Dean Martin. Dean Martin's my favorite singer of all time.
Yeah, I love Dean Martin. Dean Martin had his own swag, and it's so cool and laid back, you know, and that was just amazing time, you know, but you got to give your... You got to tip your hat to Andy Williams and Bing Crosby and Fred Astaire.
How about Donnie and Marie? Or did you like the Osmond Brothers?
The Osmonds, I never really listened to them. I mean, you heard their stuff because of television, but I never really, you know, listened to that stuff.
Yeah.
Now, what if I
might have missed something.
What would you have said before your experience on America's Got Talent? What would you have said if somebody talked to you a year before that and said, you are going to sing a duet with Patti LaBelle?
I always dreamed of that. See, here's the whole Patti LaBelle scenario. I'm a narrow down really quick for you guys. As a kid, I watched Motown 25th anniversary, and they had a special where all of those people were on there. Joe Cocker, Boy George, Luther Vandross, the Jacksons, the Four Tops, Temptations, everybody was on there. And Patti LaBelle was on there singing You'll Never Walk Alone. And she sung a song with Billy Preston and Joe Cocker, too. But ever since that moment, I've always wanted to sing with Patti LaBelle. That's when she had the big thin hairdos and the cape outfits with all the diamonds and stuff on it. I mean, and I've always said that. I was like, if I ever make it big, I want to sing with Patti LaBelle. So my mother-in-law once was telling me, like, hey, one day you're going to sing with Patti LaBelle. And, you know, I didn't think nothing of it. Going on that show, I didn't even expect to win the show. I didn't expect to. I was just wanting to fix my life. Because at that time, I had just got robbed. I was at the end of my rope. I had no clothes. I had nothing in my pocket, nothing at all. And so to go on that show was a big step for me. And then actually to get all the way through all of those levels and then get to the point of singing with any famous star that I could pick, the first choice was Patti LaBelle. Second choice was Aretha Franklin. Third was Beyonce Knowles. Fourth was Christina Aguilera. Fifth was Stevie Wonder. And the only reason I picked Stevie Wonder fifth because Stevie has a tendency of taking over.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I don't even know how you can rank that kind of brilliance.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
right.
Yeah. Well, Landau Eugene Murphy Jr., thank you so much for joining us on today's show. Again, we're going to tell everyone to check you out on Wednesday, August 3rd. Did I say Thursday earlier?
No, Wednesday.
It's Wednesday, August 3rd at the Musical Instrument Museum Music Theater. Landau Eugene Murphy Jr., thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us.
And you're an inspiration, I got to tell you.
Hey, yeah. Thank you guys so much. God bless.
Thanks.
Yeah, we talked a lot about how you inspire, I mean, how other people are inspired. You are inspired by other people, but you inspire people as well.
Oh, no doubt.
Yeah. Easy.
Thank
for you,
you
to
so
say.
Much.
And thank you, Landau.
Thank you. And this is Breakthrough Entertainment Live, 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. We'll be right back with Sean Burke. Coming right up.
And taking us out of this segment is Landau Eugene Murphy Jr. with
great
That's
voice.
Life.
Great song, great voice.
Yes.
I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself flat on my face, I pick myself up and get back in the race. I thought of quitting, baby, but my heart just ain't gonna buy it. And if I didn't think it was worth
like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion,
like I was single.
Can make an explosion and all those things I didn't say.
And welcome back again. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment Live on 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm Dave alongside Joseph J., Tricia, Eric, and the lovely Kathleen. And again, thank you to Landau Eugene Murphy Jr. What a voice that guy has. You know, I may go Wednesday. Is it too late, Joseph?
Yeah, you might. I don't know.
Really?
To where? To America's Got Talent?
No,
to the MIM.
No,
the MIM.
To the
well,
MIM.
Yeah, you can
You've
go,
been
of course.
Singing to the Periscope.
He doesn't pay attention.
You
want exactly.
to know why? You want to know why?
Because I'm
why?
Ugly?
No, because they're asking us if we would like Nick Cannon.
Who's that?
The host of America's Got Talent. So, yes, we would. Yes, please be in touch with me. I'll
Oh, they know Nick Cannon?
Yeah, I'll talk to you in a second about Nick Cannon. So that's why I was doing that.
I like Nick Cannon.
Okay.
So, yeah, I know what I'm doing. But this song is Fight Song, of course, sung by a lot of different celebrities.
Yes, but I like
Jane Fonda.
Who is this? These people singing?
This is Jane Fonda. These are all celebrities. Jane
Elizabeth
Fonda.
Elizabeth Banks put this together,
Elizabeth
right?
Banks, yeah.
Okay.
So Pitch Perfect, some of the people from that.
Elizabeth Banks, that was at the Democratic Convention?
Basically, it's the Democratic National Convention.
It's their song.
Yes, it's their song.
Oh, okay.
See,
Mandy Moore,
Hillary Duff.
I
didn't watch either of the conventions at all.
Let's get someone that may have been in proximity of the conventions, maybe inside or at least outside. Joining us right now is our friend who's been on the show many times, Sean Burke, who wrote How to Press America's Reset Button. Sean, welcome back.
How you doing? I'm happy to be back.
Well, we're happy you're here. And what I understand is, well, first of all, let's give the listeners that maybe didn't hear your other interviews. You're traveling all through the country, pretty much, trying to, I guess, I don't want to say influence, but get people aware of the concepts of your book, How to Press America's Reset Button, to really understand and learn and recognize that people have a voice, that they can pretty much vote people in and out until they get what's good for America. How would you describe that? Was I close?
Yeah. No, you're perfect, Dave. That's right. Just enlightening people that we actually have a lot more power than we probably kind of understand. It's funny. As I drive around, it's a year on the road, so I'm 9 months in, and so you and I have talked a number of times, so kind of here we are, and I'm just coming now from both conventions. And so I've learned people don't always understand that both parties are not part of the government. I just talked to someone yesterday who was astounded. Parties are individual clubs. They're private clubs. They're not part of the Constitution, not part of the government, nothing to do with it. So it's just interesting when I tell people that, they kind of they get a little brighter and realize that maybe what's going on in the parties isn't actually what is the deal with our government. These are separate entities.
That's a good point.
Well, and I really think that we also need to give the subtitle of your book, because it's How to Press America's Reset Button, a simple, safe, legal, and effective method to regain control of our government. And one of the things that we talked with you about on a previous show is that really everybody's talking about this presidential election and, oh, I can't stand Trump. Oh, I can't stand Hillary, and I just don't even want to vote or whatever. There's so many things going around on social media and everything. But what you've told us is, you know what? More important is who's getting into Congress, who's doing these other things, right? Tell us a little bit more about that.
It's true. Congress, we do have our attention on the presidential race, and I really, in some ways, blame the mass media on that, because it is the exciting thing to talk about. It's the celebrity of the election, and that's where they make their money, is off of people finding out about these people. But really, Congress is in charge of the budget, and we're $19 trillion over in debt, and this year alone, $600 billion over budget. So Congress's job is budget. They're also there to ratify treaties. They're also there to confirm judges that go on the Supreme Court, as well as all the laws in the land. So this is a very, very important group of people that we tend to ignore. And if there's something going wrong in our country, we cannot ignore them. They have the power to do everything. Really, honestly, when the presidential candidates stand up there and they start talking about some of the things they want to do, in my mind, I think, I don't know how you're going to get that through Congress. There's no way. You can promise anything you want, but you're not going to necessarily get that through Congress. So, yes, we can't forget about Congress.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And I have a few comments later on. We'll talk about both conventions. However, you were actually in Cleveland and Philadelphia, is that correct, during the convention?
Both of them, yep. I was at both conventions, correct.
Now, did you, I assume you weren't able to get into the convention. You'd probably need some type of media pass.
Actually, I do. There's a radio station out of New Hampshire that I met during the primaries that I now do a weekly update with them, and they got me a press pass, so I was in both.
Oh, wow. Really? Oh, that's really cool. So you were in both of them?
Yeah, it was, yes.
So describe that. I mean, you see it on TV. This is how, from a television standpoint, I've never been to a convention. I haven't tried to get media passes. Perhaps I could. But it looks like a production, a show and in neurolinguistic programming terms, trying to anchor people with good feelings, you know, whether it's music, celebrities, stars, motivational speaking, get you a certain state of mind, you know, the people on television, I mean, that are watching TV or at the convention, and then associating it to their particular candidate. From inside the convention, is that how it seemed to you? Just sort of a rah-rah cheerleader, didn't matter what they said type of thing?
Well, I can talk about the part about whatever they said. I will talk about that in a minute. But in general, absolutely, it is to fire up the base. It's to fire up your group. It's your chance to have 4 days of primetime coverage to talk to the American people and present your case and try to show as many people that people maybe respect or will listen to get them onto your side. So first we had the Republicans doing it, and then, of course, we had the Democrats doing it. So that is what it is. That is the job. Now, from inside, it is an arena. So imagine going to a pro basketball game, and it's mostly full. They have one section of it blocked off for the staging, but it is full of people. You have delegates, you have guests, you have media, and then I'm not sure who else they give tickets to. So this thing is pretty full. And so we get to see everything. Now, you're seeing just the actual show, but for example, just one example that you don't probably know or hear is during Hillary Clinton's speech, there were Bernie Sanders people shouting her down.
Oh.
And what happened was the Hillary supporters started chanting Hillary, Hillary, to cover up. So when you're watching and you hear these people chanting Hillary, and you think they're just excited because Hillary's up on the stage, they're actually shouting down and trying to cover up some of the shouting that's coming from the Bernie Sanders people. So I'm not saying that happened all the way through or is really a huge problem, but that's not what you see when you're on TV. You see just exactly what they want you to see, but we see a lot more what's going on in the arena during that.
But, you know, isn't that sad, though, that it takes a production to generate a certain state of mind in people watching and associating that state to the candidate? I mean, isn't, if that's the way to get elected, it seems sort of sad in a way. It has nothing to do with qualities, but who can get the most rah-rah vote, cheerleader type of production? And people don't know a whole lot anyway, right? I don't think a lot of people actually study up on this, that vote. And so it's all emotional. Wouldn't you think that's how it is?
Well, it's unfortunately, that is today's world of lots of money.
Yeah.
Lots of power. You have the media. And so, no, people really don't know behind the scenes. So what you're watching, and I wrote a blog post. I blog every single night that people can follow along and whatnot. But I blogged one night. I have seen too many times through this election cycle, I've been at a rally for a candidate, and I've watched it, and then I want to watch the media presentation or what they came out of it with, and it was not at all the same. So I wrote in this blog that all of us, it's very, very important, especially these, well, it's past now, but these conventions, if you can watch it unfiltered, it is the way to watch it because you actually hear what someone's saying instead of getting the filter through the media. And the media, and I'm not saying the media is, being directed by either party in any way. Maybe they are. I just know that they're looking for controversy. They're looking for extremes. They're looking to get you to go, oh, my God, oh, wow, oh, did you see that? And then you get clicks from it, and you get viewers, and that's where the money comes from because they're profit. They're for-profit center.
Sure.
So I've seen too much of that, and I really warn people. And maybe there's a book in my future about this because I really honestly feel the media – not just now, but for years, has really twisted our country into opposing each other, and it continues with not every outlet, but in the main, it has twisted us into really fighting against each other, and they really highlight the negative. So I just encourage people to try to get to the unfiltered source. Even then, a candidate's going to say whatever they want.
Right.
But at least you're getting what the candidate's saying, and then you can do research. Because on the net, there are sites that seem very nonpartisan that just try to give you the facts. Here's what they said. And here, I think factcheck.org is one. But we have to get to the truth, because a lot of what you see, if you're just sitting back and taking it in, is going to be slanted.
Yeah, there's no doubt. Or they will pick up on a story and drag it out for days and days and ignore some of the facts. And both convention had it. I mean, from the plagiarism, accusations
Melania.
With who was yep. yeah with Donald's wife, and then of course the hacking, the emails, with probably the most disappointed of any participant there, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, right, where
yeah.
she got I guess her hand got caught in the cookie jar, so sounded serious, sort of serious to me that. It was what, see, and let me, I don't want to make this political, but, and I'm not saying, I just listen to everyone, and so I'm not completely decided yet. However,
well, I personally don't like either of the parties.
Yeah, but the thing is what's your take on Bernie? I mean, he had so many supporters. This guy was leading a political revolution. And to me, for him to give in that quickly, when he knows, at least it seems like, with all the paid political speeches by Hillary to Wall Street, would a real leader give in that quickly or at all?
A couple of comments. First of all, there's a poll that's been done. A majority, over 50% of Americans, don't feel either party represents them. So that's just first for us to recognize.
That's a good point.
It's a huge amount of people. Number two on Bernie. I think Bernie had no other option. What could have happened if he really pushed it is he would have either gone into a third party, which that would have immediately elected probably Donald Trump, because
right.
his people and Hillary's people would have been divided. So
that's true.
He had a very, very, very tough decision to make, and he looked pained.
Yeah, I did see that. Yeah.
He looked very pained, and I'll tell you, especially after the WikiLeaks and that email that shows that they were fighting against him.
Amazing.
His supporters, I talked to many of them, they are not with him on supporting. Not, I'm not saying all of them. I don't even know what percentage.
Right.
But there is a good chunk of his supporters that will not follow him to Hillary.
Yeah.
And one guy said, I will vote potentially for the Libertarian,
yeah.
or he said, I won't vote. He goes, they don't know what to do because they can't give themselves to the point to vote for Hillary. So
yeah.
there's a real problem. I'll tell you, that's not been talked about a lot, but there's a big rift in the Democratic Party because of all of that.
Yeah, I agree. And wow, this was a fast segment. We'll get you on for sure again. But we're at the end of the show now. But I know you're coming in the Phoenix. I'll email you.